today. I hope you're having a marvelous day today. This is the Esther Davis Show, and I am Esther Davis. I have two wise men in the studio with me today. You're going to recognize the great Archbishop. You know, he lets me get away with calling him Bishop, but he's really the Archbishop, and I really need to apologize for that because I had someone to correct me. But I have another special guest. We have people that drop in, and we invite people in to the show. If you are a Christian-based person, you know the Bible, you're most welcome to this show every Monday at 1 o'clock. And I need to introduce a coach, a very famous coach, The Liberation of a Black Mind. This is an autobiography. You've heard us talk about this before. And the coach is here. Everybody has had a coach sometime, somewhere in your life. So, coach, we're happy to have you here.
Thank you.
Has the summer been nice to you?
It has so far.
So far? Well, it's almost over. The bishop, when he's here, they have a title. And we have a discussion around that title and the Bible verses that go with it.
But you know, we are comfortable with being called Joseph.
That would not work. You have an article. I am not going to do that.
They call them Grace. His grace.
Yeah. Yes. And that's, you know, that distinguishes you, I think, from the prey, because you are faithful members of the Word, the Bible, and especially after I've gotten to know them, Coach, they know they speak several languages. That's number one. Number two, and they know all of the Bibles, because I've learned more than I have given, and that's very, very important. So what are we doing today?
I think we are looking, you know, there's something that is happening, and ironically it's happening in all spheres of life, you know, the shift. The dimensional shift, spiritual shift.
Yeah, we do have a spiritual shift going on right now.
There's a shift in all areas of life today.
Made by God.
Yeah, it is said Ethiopia shall rise again, and the Eurocentric narrative of the journey of man with God is now shifting because the comforter, the teacher has come to teach man and to bring us to the accurate knowledge of the truth, because our Lord Jesus Christ made a very profound promise to humanity. He said, it is very important for you, in John chapter 16, mm-hmm. from verse number 17, from verse number 7 rather. He said, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is very, very expedient for you that I go away. You know, when somebody tells you it is very important, meaning that the work mm-hmm. I come to do mm-hmm. have been comfortably and perfectly done. So it is time we make a shift to the next level. Say, for if I do not go, the comforter will not come. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And he had three specific duties to perform. He will rebuke the world of sin, because Amen. Sin had been the problem of man from the foundation of time. He will reprove the world of righteousness, because righteousness means doing the right thing as it's supposed to be done. And he will reprove the world of judgment, because on the cross he judged sin, which is the prince of the world. Then he went further to say that he has many things to let us know which we could not bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will lead us to the accurate knowledge of the truth. Today, if you go online on YouTube, TikTok, everywhere, you see a lot of narratives. They are challenging every premise of the Christian Bible and
yes,
the Christian faith.
They are. Mm-hmm.
They are challenging the origin of man, even the origin of species. The evolution theorem as propounded by Charles Darwin is robustly challenged. Mm-hmm. Like one A.W. Tozer, is even an American evangelist. He wrote a book, said, in the beginning, God created. Then the question was, between that time when God said, let there be light, and when God made man, if you look at it, you realize that science is trying to dispute creation.
Yeah,
but on the contrary, science is proving creation.
So are we talking about science, or are we talking about demonic forces?
Well, everything in life is science, even in demonic forces. In metaphysics, what is metaphysics? It's the science of a spiritual manipulation of existence. Magic is a science.
I think anything that challenged God's design and origination, to me, would have a negative force
Agreed. But remember in Isaiah chapter 45, verse 7, God said, I create light and I form darkness.
Yes.
I create good and I made evil. Mm-hmm. So what is taking place is man is trying to prove that God is not the origin of all existence. Mm-hmm. But the creation story is so perfect. It shows the mindset of a master planner whom before he started his work had a blueprint. He planned his roadmap. He had what he wanted to do, because our Lord Jesus Christ asked that question. He said, what man before he plans to build a house did not first do the architectural survey, do the bill of quantity, do all estimates before he start building, so that you know how much his resources
the blueprint
can take care of. Mm-hmm. So if he can build a bungalow of 2 bedrooms and a sitting room and a dining, he will build it and everybody say, hey, that's a beautiful house. But he didn't have money, he started a mansion. Halfway your money is finished, people will mock at you. You started a work, you cannot finish.
Yeah, your money is already gone because the prices have gone up.
Yes.
But now, you gave me two Bible verses. I only have one.
Isaiah 45, verse 7.
45, verse 7.
Yes.
Okay.
So, you know, God now in the beginning has already thought through. That's why Genesis chapter 1, from verse number 1, said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
Well, I think the forward, in the beginning, God.
God. There was somebody already.
Yeah.
That is the master planner. Right. He is the owner. Like you have a business, you're the CEO. Mm-hmm. So before you start a project, you're already sitting in your office in authority.
Yes.
Then you start, okay, this is what we're going to do. And he looked at the heaven and the earth as a landmass filled with water. He said, let there be light. The light came in. And if the place is full of darkness and void, automatically the story of Ice Age is explained in the Bible. Because when everywhere is dark and water filled the face of the earth, it will be frozen water. It will be ice.
Yes.
Ice.
You know? So is that not the story of the Ice Age in evolution theory?
Oh, yes.
Then when God said, let there be light, once light comes into dark, into the ice environment, what happens? The heat will start forcing the ice to break. Then when God said, let the waters divide from the waters, and let dry ground appear in between. That's the Big Bang theorem.
If it was a Big Bang, who created the bang?
You understand the situation now?
Yes.
Because imagine when we have ordinary landslide.
A landslide.
Can you imagine the noise? Or when there's an earthquake and the ground is separating, the noise is horrible. Then imagine all the continents and the islands as it broke apart and they were floating on the waters. The noise would be so much. Science has it that the cockroach, the mosquito, the ant is greater, is older than man.
Oh, I believe that.
Yeah, and
because the cockroach has been here.
And the creation story said before God brought man, he said, let the ground bring forth every life after its kind. Let the air do that. Let the waters do that. Meaning the fish, the protoplasm, the plankton, the crayfish, the periwinkle, the oyster, the roach, the ant, the bird, everything.
Yeah, even the microorganisms.
Even the microorganisms.
Yes.
Were already in existence before man was made. Then finally God said, now let us bring forth our superintendent. Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, that they will have dominion over all creation. And evolution said, after all this, from protoplasm to plankton to this to that, then evolved to Homo erectus, from Homo erectus to Homo sapiens, and the first Homo sapiens is the black man. Meaning that between the evolution theory and creation theory, the first being God made was the African. And when God.
In Africa.
Yes.
Yes.
And when God said, he said in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, you know, that God molded man from the dust of the earth. Anywhere you look at the dust of the earth, it's like this. If it is a lighter dust, it's your complexion.
Yeah. That's right.
And then from that, in that dust, it breathed the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Meaning that between creation and evolution, there's a corroboration, there's no contradiction. There was one master plan. Even if evolution is a reality, God engineered the evolution.
The bishop says there's one master plan.
Yes.
And you talked about this before.
Mm-hmm.
About the master plan and how God had planned it and how we've gotten so far away from it.
Yes. And Doc, if you look at it now, when man missed the way, our Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible said in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, that God commended his love to us, man, that while we are yet deep in sin, Christ died for us.
Yes.
What was the essence of the death? There was a disconnect. There was a disobedience by the first Adam in the Garden of Eden. So the same spirit Adam came back in the body form of a man called Jesus to do what? To correct that mistake of disobedience by being obedient unto death and removing the burden of disobedience from his descendants. And he told us now that having finished his work of redeeming man from the disobedient burden, you know?
Pain and debt.
The pain and debt. Then somebody else is going to come after him who will now lead us back as it was. He said, if I could read it from the Bible, it's so explicit and clear. He said, I have many things to tell you, but you cannot understand them. So how be it when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will lead you into all truth. Say, because he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, he shall speak. John chapter 6. Everything in those.
John chapter 6.
John chapter 16, sorry.
Not he's six. Speaking of obedience. As a child, doesn't have the knowledge of how to protect himself and bring about safety. But his parents does. But in order for the child to benefit from that, he has to be obedient.
Yes.
Yes.
And it is said, if you obey, you know, the only thing, even in the human system, the most responsible career, I mean, field is the military, right?
Yes.
And what is the simple rule of the military?
Obedience.
Obey before complaining.
Obey
orders.
Yeah. Yeah. Even if again.
Obey before complaining.
Yes.
OBC.
Obey before complaining. The other part of the show is that we write things down, and we write the Bible verses down. I will give you the summary of the Bible verses when the bishop's finished. But it is important that we follow orders.
Yes.
And there is a time you don't follow orders.
And when you don't follow orders, what are the consequences?
Yeah, you suffer the consequences.
There are multiple consequences.
and you wonder, why is God being so mean to me? Why am I suffering like this?
But irony of it is, God is not mean. You know, he said in the book of Galatians chapter 3, verse 7 and 8, he said, be not deceived. God is not mocked. That whatsoever a man sows is what he shall reap. So if you of a flesh, maybe, okay, you're a father, you have a son, your ambition, you've looked at his mental aptitude, he has the capacity to be a scientist, and you're doing everything, sending him to the right school, breaking your back, keeping five jobs to make sure he doesn't have any stress but to concentrate and, you know.
So you only benefit from your actions.
Yes.
And those actions has to be
consistent.
Yes.
And if that your child, now he first his studies, for the time, you face your own duty of providing.
Yes.
He will eventually become successful. But if he goes to school and start playing, going partying, doing drugs, doing all sort of things, he will end up on the street.
Yes.
And it's not the father's fault. Man refused to obey God's order.
Man refuses.
Until today, they are trying to do it, challenging God, questioning his premises.
Yes.
But when man obeys, it is natural order of existence. God is faithful. He keeps his promises.
God gives beneficial actions, and it can be counteracted with destructive actions.
Yes.
So, but you're going to be acting either way. But it's a fork in the road.
That is true.
It's a fork in the road. I haven't heard that in a long time, Coach. We're talking to Coach, one of the coaches, Salisbury, and, of course, the bishop is here. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 verses. I hope you have written them down. If not, I will do a summary when the bishop finished the teaching. Our subject today is a continuation of something we have, 2 weeks?
Yeah,
two weeks. Third week.
This is the third week. Looking at the changeover.
Yes.
You know why I call it the changeover? Man has exhausted their knowledge. Technologically,
that's profound.
Man has gotten to the point now that we can blend objects.
Blend objects and
give them power to act.
But man is finite. And God is
infinite. Yes.
And that's what we have to understand.
And in that finite nature of man, we experiment And when the consequences of our experiment comes back to us, like Dr. Frankenstein, who created the monster.
The bishop has a sense of humor to drive things into view for you to better understand. And we have a fun, we have so much fun on this show, coaches. It's amazing, because then our audiences wants to know, what are y'all having, what are y'all smiling? So listen to the whole show. Don't tune in and halfway through. Look, listen to the whole show, and you see what, how that migrates or evacuates in the bishop's view into a comedy, something you can laugh about because it's true. Just stay tuned to us and hear the whole show.
But you know, the truth is fun.
The truth is fun.
Yeah,
yes.
The way people have problem, you know. Hey, did you take this book? Yes, I wanted to read it. Is it not simple?
It's exciting. People think that it's outdated and it's not contemporary, but it is very contemporary. It's very exciting. You know, it's not boring. It's not it requires you to move.
Yes.
You know, it requires
yes, it's
full of verbs. It's action. You know, it's things that has to happen. But it gives pure guidance to anything that you do.
And you know one thing, the problem we have with each other, eh?
Oh, that's going to be a big stop.
You know why? Yes. Because if you're used to telling the truth, your words are few.
Okay.
Yeah, it said in Matthew chapter 5, from verses 35 to 38.
We've had Matthew before.
You know, it says, swear not at all by heaven, for it is the throne of God, not by the earth, for it is his footstool, and not by your head, because you cannot make one hair black or white. But let your yes be yes, and no
let
be no.
Be
anything other than this comes from evil. Why is it so? Why do we have courts? We are in the courts to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, and any doubt that is had, you have to prove. That means it's already a lie.
Yes.
You know you committed an offense. They ask you.
You say that, Bishop. I think how many courts we have today? They're all overcrowded. They have night court.
Yes.
Trying to take care of the evil.
And what is that taking? The lies.
That's
all. Did you do this? Yes. I'm sorry. I never expected. I didn't know. Even if the punishment is 20 years and minimum is 5. The judge will likely give you 5, or
but
even
they tell you that
if you go on parole.
Ignorance of the law is no excuse.
Yes.
So, but you know, it's incumbent upon you to be knowledgeable.
But even if you're ignorant of the law, but you speak the truth,
yes,
the punishment will come as a lesson to deter you from doing it again.
Yes.
But unlike the one you take years, guilty or not guilty, I'm not guilty, you start the story, then you start cooking up lies and counter lies and stories to cover up the former one.
Yeah.
Because it's a process. Once you start lying.
Lying is a process.
Yes.
Yeah, once you start.
You cannot stop. And the Holy Father leader, Olumba Obu, the founder of Brotherhood of the Cross and Star, told us something. He said the problem in the world, why we have courts, police station, the army, the paramilitary, that we spend vast resources that could have made a life better, in providing instruments that destroy us, because everything we make in the military industry is to destroy.
Yeah.
There's nothing constructive in it.
No, nothing.
Now, why do we have to create things to destroy us when by simply loving one another, by simply being truthful to one another, by simply accommodating one another, we'll have peace?
But when you talk about the laws and the court system, it comes to mind that the civil disobedience. When you have people that are refusing to obey an unjust law, and you want to be law-abiding, but if it's a law that's unjust, you know, you can't truthfully adhere to it, and it causes a rebellion.
You see, you already used the word unjust. That unjust is a very big word. Why is it unjust? Why did the person propagate such an unjust law? Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 said, Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Now, the person that is putting up a law, maybe to put a body of a people down, you
it
know?
It becomes political.
You know,
laws.
That's what I'm saying. Now, why are they doing it? They are ignorant.
Yeah.
Because that law he puts forward destroys both him and the people he's putting it up against.
Yes.
It is easy to start anything you like in life because in the myopic concept, you would think in your narrow mind that, hey, it's going to destroy this particular person. But by the time you put it into the public domain, it becomes like a loose cannon. You don't know whom it's going to kill. So the laws they propagate, it is that fallen nature in man. And if you look at it today, even in the United States of America, with due respect to everybody who cares to feel offended, people have neglected the word of God. They've neglected the guide of the Holy Scriptures.
Yes, we have created new gods.
And when you create those gods, what do you create? You create problems for yourself because the law of God is right. He said the word of God is a strong tower.
In the word
of God, the righteous
run
into it and is safe.
Lies utopia.
Yes.
That's a term that people in their mind think is impossible. But it's highly possible if you adhere to, if everybody uniformly are able to adhere to it.
Yes, because if you look at it, what's the greatest commandment Christ gave to man? The young man asked him, tell us, what is the greatest commandment? Very simple.
Yes.
He said, one, you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind.
Yes.
And second to that is only one law. He said, you should love your neighbor as yourself.
Oh, back to our famous slogan, you know, love thy neighbor.
And when you remember, who is your neighbor? You're moving on the street. So you saw somebody lying on the ground, wounded. Our Lord Jesus Christ even used it to give an example, describe the neighbor. He said, the Good Samaritan. He saw a man. That man was lying, wounded. Nobody know who inflicted the injury on him. The priest was going to service. He wants to go and keep church service for his members, right? He saw the man lying in that condition and ignored him because he doesn't want to miss the time in the worship.
Don't have time.
Yes. Then the other man came, oh, I'm a worshiper. If I don't get on time to the church, the priest will reject me. The council will do this to me. He or she ran away too. But the man that was going, a Samaritan, he said he doesn't know whether there is God. It's not his business. What all he knows is that he's a wayfarer. He travels every day. He could be in that condition. And that could be his lot.
Yes.
So what did he do? He tended to the man's wound, took him to the clinic, deposited some money, told the clinic doctor, say, you know me, I pass through this route every day.
Yes.
Next time I'm going to come back, whatever is the outstanding of the bill, I will pay it. He went his way. He didn't go to synagogue.
Amazing.
He didn't go to a church. But Christ said, that man is the true man that loves his neighbor. So if we realize that people think neighbor is your brother, your son, your wife. No.
Yes.
Your family could be, you know, in Montana, and you're in Dallas. The most important person to you in Dallas is the man living next door.
Yes.
But since we live atomistic lives, individual, nobody wants to know about the other. That's why we are physically in the same space. But mentally and emotionally, our filaments are like this, over the head of the neighbors. But if we are connected, we realize that it is easy to pass policy knowing that if it affects your neighbor, it will affect you. Unjust laws will not come into existence because it is not addressing a particular individual, it is addressing the entire body. So it is easy to remedy the situation, but first and foremost, we must re-engineer our minds.
You know, you make me think of a very famous story in my life. We grew up in the country roads. Short story, my dad's driving a truck, my brother and I are in the back of the truck. My dad stopped to pick up a guy. He says, where are you going? The guy says, I'm going to so-and-so. So daddy says, just hop in. Down the road a bit, about 5 miles, the man gets out of the car and he says, how much do I owe you? He says, just pass it on. Now, as kids sitting in the back of a truck, we have no idea. My brother was younger than I was. He says, what is he talking about? Pass what on? He didn't get any money.
Instead of collecting the bucks.
And I've often thought about that story over the years, because we need to pass these things on. Like mm-hmm. you say, take care of your neighbor. Doesn't matter what country the neighbor is from, mm-hmm. because somebody is over here taking care of your people wherever mm-hmm. they possibly is. Mm-hmm. What are y'all? So that story just came to mind so vividly, because it took us probably 10 years before I really understood.
Yes.
But my dad was talking about pass it on. Mm-hmm. There was no money exchanged. No. He didn't know the guy.
But he passed on love.
Yes, yes.
When the man meets another man, I think some Indians did a comedy of it. A lady was making a call. Some money dropped from her hand. So the other lady picked it up and brought to her notice. As she collected the money, she wanted to give the lady some money. Mm-hmm. The lady mm-hmm. told her, pass it on. Then a young man had an issue somewhere. Mm-hmm. He was trying to pay for his taxi, and the taxi didn't have change, and it was causing a problem. That lady whom the other lady helped and told to pass it on, man, what's your problem? He said, I needed to pay this guy 2,000 rupees, and I have 20,000 rupee note, and he doesn't want to give. The lady paid for him. I said, how do I pay you back? Let's go and get some change. He said, no, pass it on. The young man got to a grocery store, saw a poor man that went to buy some items. His money is not enough to pay for his family, and the family is very hungry. The man paid for him. He said, please follow me to the house. I have some money. I'll pay you back. He said, no. Pass it on. You see how the love is going.
Yes.
Now, and by the time we do like that, mm-hmm. that is the brotherhood of life we are talking about. You understand? The beauty, yes. we realize that we are like ripples of the water. Yes. When you drop, it keeps expanding, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. expanding, all encompassing. The young man you helped to overcome a problem mm-hmm. may have been gone to rob somebody else and kill the person just for $10. In giving that $10, you have saved their life. Save the young man, and you created an environment of appreciation. You say, we are better together, mm-hmm. and we are all we need.
Yes.
Alone, yes. we can walk very fast. Together, we can walk very far, and we can achieve much.
That's the process of mankind.
Yes.
And that involves all levels up and across
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
that will solve the ills of society.
Yes, true.
But coming from the generosity of the heart.
Yes.
The generosity of the heart. We've had several lessons on the heart, but mm. one of the greatest series I think we've ever had, Bishop, is Love Thy Neighbor.
Yes, and that is the generosity he's talking about.
That's what he's talking about.
You know, if you look at the life we are living today,
wow.
all the problems we have, it is when I say, I want to be a millionaire. I'm a billionaire. Mm. Go to that billionaire's house. They cook $1,000 worth of food. All he could eat may not be up to $10.
True.
Yes.
Yes.
He has a 1,000-bedroom mansion, a big palace, all the space. All he could space, maybe if he's somebody, a brief man of 5 feet, weighing some maybe 120, 130 pounds. So he would just perch in one corner of the bed like a little sparrow. That is all he gets in the 1,000-bedroom mansion. Mm-hmm. The rest is vanity.
The rest is vanity.
It is mine. I am the big boy. But if we understand the law of life, that when you help A, it connects to B. Like Isaac Newton, this man who discovered penicillin in Scotland. I remember his name. The then prime minister's father, Churchill, mm-hmm. saw him. His father was a farmer. Very poor farmer in the Scottish lowlands. He helped him, and in helping the father was able to train the son, who later discovered penicillin. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when Winston Churchill fell sick, he had pneumonia, mm-hmm. and they needed penicillin to treat him. Getting to the clinic, it was this young man, Churchill's father, helped become somebody that recovered, helped Churchill recover his health. If his father had not helped that poor farmer, and the poor farmer trained the son to become a doctor, a physician, a researcher, mm-hmm. and discovered penicillin, Churchill would die. So the father, in helping that young man's father, saved his own son's life.
And that's what life is about. It comes back. The good that you do comes back.
But I hate the reversal of that. The guy that developed the blood plasma,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and he mm-hmm. saved all these people's lives. But then when it was time for him to get a blood treatment,
I remember you telling me that.
The discrimination, mm-hmm. they would not let him get it because he was black.
Mm-hmm.
And he died?
Well, you see, that is the mission, the next level the Holy Father has come to correct today. You know, one thing about man, remember what we said in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Mm-hmm. Due to this ignorance, and ignorance is a great disease.
Yes.
Yes.
America, they call it the land of the free. There's a lot of inconsistencies and complexities in the system, you know. And most of the time, God does not give you the best thing in the environment you think it will come. That's why the greatest wisdom comes in the simplest form.
Yes.
Now, in trying to block or segregate or navigate against a particular body of people, in the long run, impact on the society. You understand?
Yes.
More, because when there's a resentment and fear and disharmony, mm-hmm. nobody's at peace. If you look at the world today,
it's not
even just United States of America. If you go across the world, in Africa, in Asia, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth, you see this problem is obtaining.
Like you said, the spirit is changed, because there's more wars currently today,
yes.
mm-hmm. than ever in any time in history.
Yes, because
yes.
man has become more self-centered.
Yes.
We are not thinking in the context of we.
No, we're thinking about just
I.
They.
Me, myself, yes. and I. Them and us.
Yes.
Yes.
You know? And when it becomes them and us,
yeah.
after all said and done, you realize that at the end of the day, you must still have to come back. That vision of Martin Luther King Jr., that one day the children of the former slave masters and the children of the former slaves will come together for dinner at the table of brotherhood.
Yes.
The way the world is going today, how they, even if they are thinking today that they can reverse this as it used to be in the past, that is a wild dream. It cannot take place. The world is getting so deeply interwoven.
Mm-hmm.
And it's getting so integrated that if we refuse to follow the principles of Christ,
yes.
right.
to follow in the footsteps of the eternal brotherhood,
mm-hmm.
where God did not create two people, he created only one people, the human family.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we come back to that context of the human family, and that's the next level we're talking about,
mm-hmm.
he that is coming now to teach us that together we can achieve. And
yes.
if we want to destroy each other, if you look at United States of America today, mm-hmm. any human being projecting racial sentiments
yes.
is simply determined to destroy America.
Yes.
And if Americans must be sincere, let me say this truth, let all of us here, as a kingdom,
mm-hmm.
United States is approaching 250 years.
Yeah.
And when a kingdom hits the 250-year mark, if the people of that kingdom do not manage it very well, it will start declining.
Yes.
And,
we can see the mm-hmm. decline.
Yes. And the decline starts from the inside.
Yes.
What
yes.
destroys the kingdom is within itself.
You know, job applications they have on there, you know, your race and the ethnicity
yes.
and all that. And when I get to that point, and not just jobs, but anything you're applying for, I always I've started to put human.
Mm-hmm. Because that's the only race.
That's the only race.
The human
what
race.
What are you putting on your job applications and all of these this paperwork on your insurance policies? And why do they need all of that distinction in the first place?
No, divisive.
Because people think this is mine. This is ours.
This world is mine.
Not just even in America. Even in my home country in Nigeria, they say put your tribe. That is another form of division.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, maybe this one is Igbo man, the Yoruba man is there, the Hausa, and we have about 300 to 400 distinct languages.
Yes.
Really?
Yeah. Yes, and
yeah.
close to
yeah.
3,000 to 4,000
yeah.
distinct dialects.
Yeah, I think that they count.
3,000 to 4,000
distinct dialects.
Amazing.
So that makes it, some people that if you're looking for a part of the Babel,
mm-hmm.
the time of Nimrod, go to Nigeria,
yeah.
you'll find it.
Yeah.
Now, if we agree to a common denominator, we are Nigerians,
mm-hmm.
and remove your language or your tribe,
mm-hmm.
you see that the best neurosurgeon could be from this tribe.
Mm-hmm.
The best physiologist will be from the other side.
Right.
The best engineer will be from this side. If you gather them together in a pool,
yes.
they make the nation great.
Yes.
And it's the same thing like here in America. Ben Carson is an African-American. Mm-hmm. You have others from the European-American environment, isn't it?
Yeah.
Asian-American, and so on and so forth. Now, when you bring them together in the context of their capacity,
yes,
not in the color of their skin,
mm-hmm. yes,
and you look at the content of their character, not in their orientation.
Exactly.
Then by the time they come, they pull in their resources like they did in ancient Egypt, in Memphis, the city Alexander the Great conquered and named Alexandria.
Mm-hmm.
In the city of Memphis, in the school of eternal brotherhood, all knowledge is pooled together.
Yep.
Nobody owns it. It was only when Aristotle came as the teacher of Alexander that he decided to appropriate all to himself, claiming to be the father of all philosophies. But the one he could not claim is that Euclid was a black African who is the father of the philosophy of mathematics. The whole idea is in that school of eternal brotherhood,
mm-hmm.
all knowledge is universal. It is for the common good. And when we pull it for the common good, we'll have peace in the world. That is why Christ came to die,
yes.
for the unity of creation. That's why the Holy Father, Lido Lumbo Lumbo Bu, has come back on earth today to lead us back to what was, because there's nothing new under the sun.
Right.
Hebrews chapter 13 verse 8 said, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, the same today, the same forevermore. So if he is the same yesterday, the same today, and the same forever,
that
meaning
is,
that God is constant.
Yes.
Yes.
Truth is constant. Love is constant. It is only in our application. When we misapply love, it brings doom.
Misapplying love. This has been
that sounds like oxymoron.
It does sound like, but it's something that we could, but it's something that we can use. I love the statement. I love a lot of your statements. I really do. But I think today I love my favorite one is going to be ignorance is a disease.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Terminal.
It's terminal.
a pandemic.
It's a pandemic, and we've been in it a long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
My guest today has been, of course, the coach, because the Archbishop is here several times a month. When he's not traveling, and we miss him dearly, won't you know we miss you when you're traveling. We miss him when he's traveling. By the way, before we get out of here, today's lesson has been Israel 4, 5, and 7, Genesis 1, 1, and Genesis 2, 7.
Yes.
Romans, I didn't get the verse, Romans something. What do you recall? And the other Bible verses, John 16, one of our favorites, Galatians 3, 7 and 8, Matthew, love Matthew when we talk about Matthew, Hosea 4 and 6.
Yeah.
You've been wrapping that around us a lot.
Yeah, because the whole, you know why it's everything is always wrapping around Hosea?
Why?
Everything we do is anchored on ignorance.
It really is.
You know, there was this story. Eh? Uh-huh. A man is a doctor. He owned a very powerful clinic. And he had a policy that no matter the state of the patient, they must make a reasonable deposit before treatment could be given. Now he had a nurse in his hospital.
Mm.
A patient was brought. She did not see the patient. They said, please, I said, no, the hospital policy must be maintained. She argued and argued and argued. While arguing, the patient died. Now, when she went to see the patient, it happened to be her only son. It's a real life story.
Mm-hmm.
So that ignorance in the process, my people say you went to a place, you parcel maybe a big nylon filled with mud,
mm-hmm.
and cast it into the marketplace from an overhead bridge.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You don't know whether it's going to explode on your father's head, on your mother's head, on your child's head. So when you cast out love into the world, it touches everything. And when it sends out hatred into the world, what happens? It brings back doom, brings back destruction.
It comes back to you.
The law of attraction, what you sow gets back to you. So let us sow love. The next level the Holy Father came to teach man is nothing other than this. There's no religion. We made religion.
Mm.
With all respect. There's no religion. At
there's
all.
No religion.
There's no religion. Religion is man's creation.
Yeah.
The only religion God gave to man is love.
Yes.
And the love can be applied in many ways. Anyhow you apply it, love brings life. Love brings peace. Love brings good health.
Mm-hmm.
Love brings progress. Like this one you're talking now. Look at the state of America. At the peak, it's descending. Why? all the development, all the technology, all the inventions are there. New ideas are coming out.
And we're but so divided.
Instead of rising with it,
yeah,
there's no security. Every day, like Amy told us the other day about the mass shootings all over mm-hmm. the place.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why are people killing each other? A young man will get up, walk to a shopping mall, pull like whatever, and start shooting.
And now we have become so adapted
mm-hmm.
to mass shootings, we don't report them all. And we find out later on, depending on what news media you're looking at, that this happened over here, we didn't know anything about it. It's just a part of our everyday lives. You know what, though? We have run out of time. it always happens. But the beauty of coming to see what Esther Davis is doing is that we have the bishop here to give us this unprecedented training. You have to take something away from every lesson. And today my takeaway, what is your takeaway? What is your takeaway? My takeaway is ignorance is a disease. So if you're discriminated against, if whatever is happening, you've got to tell yourself, ignorance is a disease. You know what? Thank you so much, Coach. We appreciate you coming back. We appreciate you dropping in to see us. This is his book.
And you know what? Let's just give everybody one tip.
Yes.
If you're faced with ignorance, remember what Jesus Christ said. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Because if they had known, they would not do it. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us. You really are the greatest audience in the world. Come back next time the bishop is here and every day you can listen to us. We really appreciate you. Have a wonderful, fabulous week. That was great, Bishop. It's always great.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue.